Centaur Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents In the Land of Armadillos by Helen Maryles Shankman, narrated by Elizabeth Wiley. Our eyes register the light of dead stars. Andre Schwarzbart, The Last of the Just. In the Land of Armadillos. The man took up his pen and wrote, "My own darling, from my new office I can see the village square. The houses are very old, with slanted roofs, all painted cheerful colors. In the distance I can see church spires, little cottages with thatched roofs, lovely rolling fields. Just outside my window, a cherry tree has burst into bloom. All day long I have been going around like I'm sleepwalking, remembering the day I met you, when we went for that long walk under the cherry trees in the Stadtwald, and the blossoms filled the air like snow. I couldn't tell you then, but I was trembling with desire as I picked them one by one out of your shining hair. You scold me for my lack of letters. Well, my darling, you can hardly blame me for that. They keep moving me around, putting me where I am most needed, but finally I have a posting where I can receive mail. Now I am sitting at my own desk, in my own office, looking out the window of our new home. Your new home, my darling. Dearest little bunny, I wake up, I go to work, I sign papers, I direct people to go here, to go there, to do this and that, but all day long, I am thinking of you. How can I describe how much you mean to me? The touch of your hand, your trusting smile." "My secretary has just walked in with an armload of work for me to do, so I must say goodbye now, but I dispatch this to you with 100 kisses. Save some for yourself, and give the rest to Peter, my brave little soldier. I am enclosing some new stamps for his collection. I can't wait until we are together again. Nothing makes any sense without you by my side. Your adoring husband, Max." With care, he folded the letter around the stamps, slid it into an envelope, sealed it, laid it in his outbox. That done, he took a leather-bound diary from his desk drawer and smoothed it open to a new page. After noting the date in the top left corner, he wrote, "Seems that I am general of the Jews again. This time they've put me in charge of the work details, assigning them to the jobs they are best suited for. I can't complain. At least it's indoors, better than my last position, where I always had to be ready to march off into the forest to do a job, no matter how foul the weather. Shooting women and children is not what I signed up for. I'm a soldier. I miss the smoke and strategy of the battlefield. Still, a soldier must do what he is told, or all discipline disappears and the war is lost. Anyway, that's all over now. For my calm demeanor in the disposition of difficult duties, I have been rewarded with a promotion and this beautiful villa overlooking the market square. My years of hard work are finally paying off. Still, I am left with some disquieting images. The composure of the Jewish women as they dug their own graves. The courage of the men who offered no pleading, no tears. And I cannot forget the attractive figures of pretty young girls as they put down their shovels and turned to face me. At least I did what I could to ensure that they didn't suffer. Those who came up before my rifle fell without a sound. Only in that moment, as I sighted down the barrel, pointed it at their hearts, did I feel a flutter of emotion. Otherwise, I ate well, I slept like a baby. I should feel something, shouldn't I? What does it mean? I can see that having my own office is making me something of a philosopher. I still have so much to do before my little Hassenpfeffer gets here. All in all, I am confident that everything will be better when I am together with my family again, I am counting the days. It was the end of October, and still Gerda hadn't arrived. One thing after another conspired to keep Max Haas the solitary occupant of the magnificent villa. First, Gerda had wanted Peter to finish the school year with his friends. Then she had wavered about leaving her parents behind in Köln. The most recent delay was due to her fears over an increase in deadly attacks by those murderous partisans. And in the meantime, the villa wasn't ready. The walls needed plastering, the pipes were leaking. Max sighed. What he needed were skilled construction workers, plumbers, painters. Instead, he was issued a steady parade of dentists, tailors, furriers, and law clerks. Irritated, he assigned them to a crew digging drainage ditches and sent them on their way. It was the end of the day. He told his secretary he was leaving and went to see if Gruber was in his office. Max knocked. There was a flurry of sounds from within. Then something fell and rolled slowly across the floor. The door opened, and Gruber's secretary emerged, flustered and a little breathless. His boss from the Sicherheitspolizei was seating himself behind his desk. He was a cheerful, heavy-set man with sparse black hair and a square, pleasant face, which was now flushed and damp. "I'm going," Max said.
"Oh,"
Gruber said in surprise, looking at the fat gold watch on his wrist.
"How did it get so late? Will we see you tonight?"
There was a party at the SS Club later, a beer fest, an opportunity to express fraternity with the enlisted men. Max always went, it was good for morale.
"Of course, and you?"
Gruber waggled his eyebrows, gave him an enigmatic smile.
"That all depends on Horny. Listen, how is it going with your villa? Are you finding workers?"
A sensitive subject.
"I find lots of lawyers and university professors, no bricklayers or house painters." "I think I may have someone for you."
Gruber leaned forward, pushed a buzzer.
"Honey, those papers I told you to put aside,"
he cooed. While he waited, Max looked out the window. An officer and a few SS men were having fun with some Jews, making them do jumping jacks in the middle of the market square. One of them, a juicy one, collapsed. The officer drew his gun and walked over to where he lay, gasping on the cobblestones. Just then, the secretary opened the door and sashayed across the room, her skirt drawn tight over her hips, the fabric clinging enthusiastically to every stride.
"I don't know anything about art,"
Gruber admitted as he slid the form across the desk.
"But I know you're looking for a painter. Honey tells me he's very famous."
"Oh yes, Sturmbannführer," she exclaimed, her eyes wide with excitement. "He's been in many exhibitions. He's even had books published. Maybe you've seen some of them. There was The Thief of Yesterday and Tomorrow, also The Town Inside the Hourglass."
She was very proud of this Tobias Ray. Obviously a local boy made good. Honey was Fuchsdeutscher, Polish-born but of German descent. Max looked down at the paper in his hands. The photograph showed a man perhaps in his early 30s, gaunt, with longish hair, dark, pouchy eyes, a small sardonic smile. Nothing much for a Jew to smile about these days, he thought.
"He can't be worse than my last painter," he said.
Gruber was caressing his secretary's cheek with a stubby finger.
"Good,"
he said, but he didn't take his eyes from the bland, pretty face.
"I'll see that he reports to you tomorrow."
Years later, alone in his cell, he would remember that morning, how the air was fresh from the east, bringing with it a smell of cows and wood smoke that was not altogether disagreeable. The sight of the cherry tree outside his window, the branches cased in clear ice, the color of the light as it fell in bars across the ashen, angular man at the other end of the table. Max was in the dining room, taking his morning coffee from the set of mice and china his housekeeper had found in the china closet, left behind by the previous owner, when the painter presented himself. Instead of shuffling in with bowed head, exhibiting the proper mix of fear and submission due to his position and race, the famous Tobias Ray shambled in and plopped himself down on a chair
folding one sharp knee over the other. He wore a chalk-striped suit that was too large for his slender frame. Max was no expert on these things, but even he could tell that the suit showed vestiges of a good tailor and an elegant cut. Later, Toby would say that he had hoped Max would shoot him right then and there for his insolence. In his cell, Max would wonder again why he hadn't.
"So," Max said, "ever paint a house?"
Tobias Ray shrugged, a simple lifting and dropping of the shoulders.
"Standartenfuhrer Gruber's secretary is very impressed with you. Are you fucking her?"
A smile threatened the corners of the artist's mouth. Max could almost hear his thoughts. "If I smile, he'll beat me. If I don't smile, he'll beat me."
"No. Well, what have you painted?"
There were dark smudges under his eyes.
"I used to paint watercolors,"
he said.
"Oil paintings, in the surrealist manner. Your Führer would probably find my work degenerate. Do you have any examples?"
The gray lips lifted in a bleak smile, and now he resembled the black and white picture on his work papers.
"No, but you do."
He gestured at a stack of boxes in the corner, arrived yesterday from Köln. Poking out of the top was a snow globe from Berchtesgaden, some plush animals, picture books.
"That book, the one on top, it's mine."
Max's eyebrows arched up. He retrieved the book and ruffled through the pages, smiling at the depictions of cinnabar-colored armadillos perambulating over electric blue hills. It had been so long since he'd seen his family. His son was little more than the memory of a dark head on a pillow.
"In the Land of Armadillos, this is Peter's favorite book. You did this?"
The artist shrugged again. Max found himself moved to offer the man a cigarette, leaning forward to light it for him. Tobias Ray wound his skinny body around his seat and blew smoke into the air, barely looking grateful. Max tried to keep the enthusiasm from his voice.
"You're very talented. What else have you done?" "Theater sets," he said, "in Vienna. Opera sets once for a friend in Warsaw. Murals for Sheik's dining room. Chick was my dealer." "Sounds like fun. You must know a lot of interesting people."
For an instant, the look the artist returned was unmistakably ironic. Then he shifted his gaze to the trail of smoke dissipating into the air. Max realized his mistake. Of course. They were probably dead now. The interview was depressing him. He clapped the book closed with more force than he had intended, making Tobias Ray jump. The noise was like a gunshot in the quiet room.
"Come on, Ray, cheer up," Max said in an affable voice. "You're going to be fine here. I want you to paint some murals for my son's room. He's arriving in a few weeks. You'll have to hurry."
The next morning, his new employee presented himself at 10 a.m., 2 hours late. Any other day, Max might have shot him, but he was already behind on his other duties, so today he let it go. Last night, he'd been having a wonderful time in Reinhardt's castle, a medieval hunting lodge belonging to some departed Polish earl. Reinhardt himself was at his table, along with some of the brightest lights of local party society. Chief Engineer Faulkner, who rolled his eyes and complained about how long his damned drainage operation was taking, Rolfe, Gestapo chief of the district, who said little but drank heavily and was surprisingly jolly, Hackendall, Rolfe's protege. Cold and efficient, he had studied law before taking to the streets as a brown shirt. Gruber, who beamed at Max from across the table, his face shiny and red, while his eyes followed Honey as she flitted from table to table, wearing a gold gown that was tight across the breasts. Reinhardt had a marvelous chef. There was game from his forest, venison, boar, grouse, duck, rabbit, all prepared from good German recipes. With dinner, one could have French brandy, Scottish whiskey, Polish vodka, Czech Slivovitz, and with dessert, a fruity German Riesling. Max had just discovered over an apple strudel that melted on the tongue that he shared with Rolfe a lively common interest. They were both in the process of training a new cook when Gruber called him aside.
"Sorry, Haas," he began apologetically. "Something's come up. We caught a group of Jews in the forest outside of town, and I need you to take over."
"Why me?" Max protested unhappily. "I don't do that anymore. Ask some of the other officers, or the men. They love shooting Jews."
"Oh, that's just the problem," confided Gruber morosely.
He glanced around the room, at the men in their dress uniforms, the ribbons, medals, and braid on their chests, refracting the light of the chandeliers like the flashbulbs of many miniature cameras.
"Just between you and me, they love it a little too much. I know that what we are doing here is for the benefit of mankind, but when I think of what it is doing to their souls... Something happened today during a perfectly routine operation. Some of our men behaved abominably. Babies, bayonets."
He took off his glasses, rubbed his red eyes with fat fingers. Max noted that his hands were shaking.
"What are we doing to them, Max? How can we send them back to Germany, to their mothers, their wives, their children, after the things we've made them do?"
Max glanced around uneasily, worried that someone was listening in on their conversation. He had never heard Gruber talk this way. Was it a test? A trap? Or was he cracking? With a quick motion, his superior gulped down what was left in his glass. An involuntary shudder followed by a forced smile.
"That's why I'm asking you. With you, there's no circus, no hysterics, no fuss, 1, 2, 3, and it's over. I don't know how you do it. You have a way with them." "Seems that I am general of the Jews again."
A muscle at the base of his skull was throbbing. He flexed his neck right, then left, until he felt a click.
"How many?" "A small job, 23. They must have been hiding out somewhere."
After so many of these lousy operations, what was one more?
"Send a driver to my villa, first thing in the morning. I want this over with before breakfast."
Gruber squeezed his arm, bent close enough so that Max could smell the brandy on his breath.
"I won't make a habit of this, Haas. You're a good man."
Max led his new employee up a narrow passage of stairs to the top floor. At this hour of the morning, beams of sunlight streamed in through the windows, heating the space with a voluptuous warmth. The walls were newly plastered, as chaste as the feathers in an angel's wing. There was a bare bed, a desk, a chest of drawers, a pair of tailor's dummies left by a previous owner. As if he had been placed there for the purpose of contrast, Tobias Ray slouched over by the pristine white wall, the very picture of doom and gloom.
"What happened to you, Ray? Stay up too late dancing?"
The circles under his artist's eyes had grown darker, if it was possible, the stubble on his long face longer. Max offered him a cigarette from a gold case, then took one himself. Smoke waltzed in lazy spirals with the dust motes in the bare room.
"So, what are you going to paint for me?"
Tobias Ray spoke slowly and deliberately.
"I'm sorry for your trouble, Sturmbannführer. Someone should have told you. I don't paint anymore."
Max considered this for a moment, then pulled out his pistol and jammed it into the hollow under the artist's cheekbone. With a satisfying click, he relaxed the safety catch. The bereaved eyes stammered shut. Sturmbannführer Maximilian Haas was not an introspective man. He believed in neither God nor an afterlife. He was a man of medium height and build, with plain looks of moderate intelligence. As a schoolboy, he'd never excelled at anything. His grades were nothing to brag about. Before he joined the Nazi party, he'd been a machinist. But as he stood there, his finger curled around the trigger of a gun pressed into another man's head, Max came to a startling conclusion. Tobias Ray wasn't being disrespectful. Tobias Ray wanted to die. The arm holding the gun fell to his side.
"What's the matter with you, Ray?" he asked, curious. "Why don't you want to paint anymore?"
The shadowy eyes opened, recognized that the risk of imminent death had passed. Max could tell that he didn't know whether to be relieved or disappointed. Wearily, he replied,
"With death circling all around us, the practice of making these chicken scratches seems ridiculous to me. I feel like I am mocking the dead."
Max thought,
"It's not ridiculous to want to live, Toby. May I call you Toby? You know what your problem is. You think too much. For now, all you have to do is work, okay?"
When he sucked on the cigarette, Max could see a cut shaped like a crescent moon where he had socked his gun into the starved cheek.
"What do you want me to paint?"
Since yesterday, the box with Peter's possessions had moved upstairs. Max paged through In the Land of Armadillos until he found the picture he liked.
"This one," he said, pointing to the parade of red armadillos trundling up and down blue hills.
Leaving the cigarette dangling from his lips, the artist took up a pencil and squinted at the wall behind the bed. In his black pants and black shirt, he was pitiably scrawny, reminding Max of a broken umbrella, ribs inverted by the wind. With a pencil in his hand, Toby's entire affect changed. His back straightened, realigned. His shoulders relaxed and, with that small adjustment to his posture, broadened. He seemed to grow several inches taller all at once. Simultaneously, the muscles in his face tautened to a kind of concentration Max usually associated with animals of prey. Inhabiting his element the way a lion inhabits the savannah, Toby radiated power and confidence. He lunged forward and began to draw. With a single undulating line, he brought forth a series of rolling, round-topped mountains. Max watched, entranced, as he feinted back, frowned, then darted forth to add palm trees and tufts of grass. With an intense flurry of strokes, Toby outlined a chubby armadillo. Before Max's astonished eyes, the picture in the book came to life.
"My God," he said,
the words burst out involuntarily. Now Toby seemed to remember that Max was in the room. He glanced at his drawing, gave him a wry smile.
"Well, boss, what do you think?"
Max was confused. In the white room, watching the thin, pale man in dark clothes summon forth images from the air, he felt an elation not unlike the awe he had experienced when he was a child in church. He shook his head to clear it of the dreaminess that had settled over him. An office full of work awaited his attention.
"You look like you're going to faint," he grunted. "I'll send up some breakfast."
In the following days, Max was preoccupied with a whole Pandora's box full of problems. Jews were pouring in from everywhere. There was a transport from Vienna, one from Krakow, another one from Skorodnica, all needing evaluation, labor assignments, housing. A crew of Jewish stonecutters complained that they were being mistreated by their employer and refused to go back to his shop. They wanted assurances that the abuses would stop. Furthermore, the Jewish council was screwing around, unwilling to come up with a list of people who were too old, too sick, or too worn out for employment, having finally figured out what it meant when a large group of Jews was assembled for a walk in the woods. Up until now, the Judenrat had done everything they were asked. The time was right for his first visit. It wasn't that the ghetto was walled off or fenced in with barbed wire. Still, it bore all the signs of involuntary incarceration. The trees were dead, the crumbling buildings displayed leprous facades, The paving stones were cracked and missing. The gutters were swollen with an oily black runoff fed by melting snow. A fading, outdated movie poster peeled from a kiosk advertising Gone with the Wind. A flyer demanding that Jews turn in all furs was tacked over it. Here and there, Max could see a house destroyed at the beginning of the war and never repaired. Color had fled the Jewish quarter. The houses were gray, the snow was gray, the shingles were gray, merchandise in shop windows, faces too. On the sidewalk, Yids scattered at his approach, scurrying across the street to the other side. Children stopped playing as he strode by, observing with wide eyes the shiny death's head badge on his officer's cap, the billowing skirts of his overcoat, his gleaming leather boots. The offices of the Judenrat looked like offices anywhere else. A desk, a telephone, a receptionist, rows of ledgers, a potted plant, the clatter of women typing in another room. There was a flutter of activity at his arrival. The members of the Jewish council emerged from their offices, looking prosperous and harried. When enough of them had gathered around, peppering him with explanations and concerns, he handed his coat to the receptionist, pulled out his pistol, and shot them. From Max Haas's diary, November 1st, 1942. 15 men, well-dressed, cultured, with beautiful manners. I didn't enjoy shooting them, but it was the quickest way to get their cooperation. The list of names I requested will be in my hands by morning. This is wartime. There are the victorious and the vanquished, and unfortunately for them, they belong to the side of the vanquished. I didn't write the rules, that's just how it goes. From now on, I expect the Jewish council will be more compliant. From his letter to Gerda Haas, November 1st, 1942. The most exciting news. You're never going to guess who I found to paint murals in Peter's room. Tobias Ray, what do you think of that? He's painting some scenes from In the Land of Armadillos. Please don't tell Peter. I want it to be a surprise. How are my little soldier's riding lessons coming along? Tell him that Lilo is a little lame from a fall she took during a hunt, so she's getting a good rest in the barn right now, but when he gets here, we'll go riding all the time. My dearest, darling sweetheart, how I miss you. Today, I am thinking in particular of your little bunny nose and your little bunny chin and the softness of your hair when I put my fingers through it. How I long to be alone with you in our little den. All this romantic talk doesn't sound much like your old Max, does it? The closer the day of your arrival comes, the faster my heart beats for you. The tall clock in the stairway chimed 10 times as Max climbed up the steps. At the threshold of the nursery, he pushed open the door. He caught his breath, speechless with delight. Using the word red to describe the armadillos would have been laughingly inadequate. The color was scarlet or carmine or madder lake boiling crazily into a neon sunset orange, overflowing into an ecstasy of bronze, cinnabar, rust, before finally bleeding back into crimson. A wide swash of blue was brushed exuberantly around the outline of each armadillo, a pure burning hue he had seen only once before, in a painting of the Virgin. Max was just returning home from the cinema, a gala premiere for a new German film. A young, handsome scientist was developing a top-secret weapon that would win the war for Germany. Disaster struck when a foolish secretary let the secret slip to her new boyfriend, who, surprise, surprise, turned out to be spying for the enemy. Order was restored in the end. The handsome scientist shot the traitorous spy and married his virtuous blonde fiancée, and the foolish secretary learned a tough but valuable lesson. Max loved movies, especially movies like this one, thrillers that delivered a timely political message. Toby was standing in the middle of the room, his thin arms crossed over his chest, lost in contemplation. There was something glamorous about him, Max thought, a certain inborn elegance, as if he belonged to a lost branch of a forgotten monarchy. He had already begun sketching out the next mural, which showed the armadillo Aramis and his lady love Bianca at the café they opened together in Paris. Men in Homburg hats soared through the air, while fantastic animals of every shape and color populated the little round, marble-topped tables. Bianca, the blue cockatoo, was in her white apron, Aramis, his vest and bow tie. Max barely stopped himself from clapping his hands with childish joy. Under his protection and with a steady diet, Max had expected Toby to fill out a bit, or at the very least, to cheer up. But if anything, he looked worse, the lines in his elongated face etched too sharply for his 30 years, the angles of his body growing more extreme by the day.
"You've got to stop fucking Gruber's secretary," Max growled, plopping heavily onto the bed.
Startled from his trance, Toby nearly lost his balance.
"I'll try, boss,"
he began to say before breaking into a harsh cough. Max removed his officer's cap and flipped it onto the desk.
"That doesn't sound good," he said. "How long have you been coughing like that?"
Toby was bent over double. It took him a moment to catch his breath.
"Since yesterday," he rasped.
Max frowned at the artist's shirt and trousers, too thin to be of any use against the eastern cold.
"You should dress warmer. It's cold as a witch's chuff out there tonight."
It was the end of a long day. There had been an action at the hospital, all the patients shot in their beds, concurrent with a raid on the orphanage. His presence had been required at both operations. A cloud of fatigue was descending over him, assisted along its journey by the champagne served at the premiere. With a sigh of relief, he unbuttoned his dress uniform jacket. He kicked off a boot, pushed the other one off with his toes. As he made himself comfortable, something nosed its way into Max's perception.
"You do have a warm coat, don't you, Toby?"
The artist shook his head, coughed lightly into his fist.
"Well, why not?"
He shrugged, his shoulders rising and falling with indifference. Max sat up straight, indignant.
"This is outrageous. We have warehouses full of clothing. I'll see to it that you get another one right away." "Don't trouble yourself. When I die of pneumonia, you'll be commended for saving the Reich the cost of the bullet." "You're not allowed to die just yet. Not before you finish Peter's room, anyway." I'm joking. Don't go anywhere. I know just the thing."
Max padded down the stairs in his socks. This late at night, there was only an oil lamp burning in the kitchen, the corners of the room sunk in murky shadow. He could have woken the housekeeper, but making the preparations himself gave him a certain proprietary pleasure. When the copper kettle began to sing, a voice from behind him murmured,
"Can I be of service, Sturmbannführer?"
With all the extra duties of the last month, he had nearly forgotten about his new cook. On the petite side, with a pleasing round rump and a small nipped-in waist, she had that dusky skin tone some of the Jews had, wan but pretty. Her eyes were large and hooded. To him, it seemed that they swam with myriad unfathomable secrets.
"I've forgotten your name," he said.
"Salzmann, Adela, Sturmbannführer."
"And how long have you been working here?"
"A month, Sturmbannführer."
Slowly, deliberately, he poured hot water over the tea leaves.
"Was it you who made that saddle of rabbit for dinner last night?"
The shoulders were bowed, the eyes cast submissively downward.
"Yes, sir."
A husky voice for such a slight figure.
Relax, he said in a tone that was meant to be congenial. "That was the best rabbit I've ever eaten. Where did you learn how to cook like that?"
"From my mother, sir."
"Well, Salzmann, the next time you see your mother, you can tell her that Sturmbannführer Maximilian Haas says her daughter is the best cook in the entire country."
"Thank you, Sturmbannführer,"
she answered, her gaze still trained on the floor.
"Call me Haas. You can go back to bed."
"Yes, Sturmbannführer,"
she said, and evanesced into the shadows beyond the door. When the tea was ready, he slowly climbed the stairs. On a tray, he balanced a tall glass set on a china saucer filled with a transparent ruby-red liquid. For himself, there was a bottle of vodka.
Here,
he said brusquely, setting it carefully down on the desk.
Oma's recipe. Tea with wine and honey. Drink up.
Toby took the glass in his slender, aristocratic fingers.
Honey, he murmured. I haven't had honey since.
He didn't finish the sentence. Closing his eyes, he brought the tea near to his nose, abandoning himself to the sweet fragrance. The lines in his face eased, faded. Without them, he looked 10 years younger. It was late. Max should have gone downstairs to sleep. But after the unusual pressures of the day, he found he was hungry for company. He sat back down on the bed.
Tell me something about yourself, Toby,
he said, stifling a yawn.
Do you have a wife, sweetheart?
The artist cupped the glass with both hands.
No wife, no sweetheart. Before the war, there was someone.
Max loosened his belt a couple of notches, slid down farther on the mattress.
So what happened? Why didn't you marry her?
It was some time before Toby answered.
She isn't the marrying type. Oh, come on. All women want to marry, to become mothers, care for a home. It's in their nature. You're not making sense. All right, then it was me. I'm not the marrying type.
Toby's smile was too quick, the hand that ran through his lank hair too unsteady. Max turned this preposterous statement over in his mind. He couldn't conceive of a man who didn't yearn for the comforts of hearth and home. An idea formed in the depths of his consciousness swirled slowly into focus.
You're hiding something. Come on, Toby, the truth.
Toby went rigid, his graceful slouch frozen into corners and edges.
The truth is, I was seeing my translator. She isn't Jewish. It wasn't illegal then. You can't arrest her for that. I'm not looking to arrest anyone. It was just a friendly question.
Toby brushed the tips of his fingers across his forehead as if he had walked into a cobweb.
The war started. She left me, but that was a long time ago. What about you? Me, what's there to know? I'm married to the prettiest, cleverest, most wonderful woman in the world. I have a son, Peter, my brave little soldier.
He felt around in his jacket for his wallet.
Here they are. Take a look.
In the small black and white image, Gerda was propping Peter up on a carousel horse. Toby accepted the photo in his pale fingers, regarded it for a moment before handing it back.
It's a nice picture, he said.
There was a soft knock at the door. Guiltily, as if he had been sharing a confidence, Max leaped to his feet, buttoning his jacket. But it was only the housekeeper.
Yes,
he said impatiently.
It's very late.
Even this hour of the night, not a single hair escaped the tight blonde bun. These Poles, such a tidy people.
Telegram, Herr Haas, she said. It came while you were out.
He took the envelope from her hand, and she left as silently as she had arrived, closing the door softly behind her. Max tore it open and scanned it, his heart beating wildly. It was from Gerda. Peter had come down with bronchitis. Their move was being postponed until after Christmas. The doctor thought he should remain where he was for now. Panic filled his throat the way wind fills a sail. Rattled by the unexpected emotion, he fumbled for a cigarette and tried to light it. When his hands shook, Toby held the match. Max took a few puffs, then angrily stubbed it out on the tray.
She's put it off again,
he said, trying to sound matter-of-fact.
Now you don't have to rush.
But his voice betrayed his agitation, and he reached up to rake his fingers through his short hair, parted with martial precision.
They should have been here months ago, but always something holds them up. First it was his allergies, then she was concerned about school. Last time it was those fucking partisans. I'd shoot them all myself if it would get her here any sooner.
His next words were so forthright, so baldly honest, that he startled even himself.
What's the matter with her anyway?
He burst out bitterly.
I haven't seen them in so long. I hope I recognize them when they get here.
God, it was good to say those words out loud. He loosened his tie and poured himself another 2 fingers of vodka.
Forget I said anything. Let's change the subject. Tell me the truth, Toby. Do artists really draw naked women?
With the hand holding the glass of tea, Toby waved indifferently at a flat case leaning against the wall, bound in marbleized paper.
I was going to ask you if I could leave my portfolio here for safekeeping. See for yourself?
He lifted the portfolio onto the bed and untied the strings. It fell open to an ink sketch of a woman lying back on a bed, her knees apart. One hand rested behind her head, the other lay lightly on the dark isthmus between her thighs.
Max felt himself grow warm all over, felt the shock of adrenaline to his brain, his throat, his balls.
In the drawing, she wore black stockings and a camisole that rode up over her breasts. At the bottom, he could read the inscription. Paris, 1938, it said.
Who is this? He demanded. A model?
The corners of the gray lips curled up in a slight smile.
A friend?
Max studied the girl in the drawing. From her dreamy expression, it seemed to him that she was enjoying herself.
What was Paris like? Exactly what you want Paris to be like. Girls willing to sleep with you for the price of a meal and a good time. Interesting people from 100 different places with 100 different opinions. Food of the gods. Streets overflowing with books and art and beautiful women. And the nightlife.
The burnt-out eyes sparked at the memory.
Frankly, in Vienna it's the same thing, only with better pastries. And the girls are kinkier. But for sheer quantity and variety. Nothing beats New York. New York, he exclaimed. What were you doing in New York? I was invited to teach in an art school there.
Max was intrigued. All he knew about New York was what he saw in the movies.
Are the buildings really as tall as they say? Did you see a baseball game? Al Capone, did you go to Coney Island? There's nothing like it. It's a city of immigrants. Everyone is from somewhere else. But that's its strength. There's an energy in New York, an attitude that you don't find anywhere else in the world. Like they can do anything with a little luck if they try hard enough. They're like children living in cloud cuckoo land, said Max, dismissing the Americans with the wave of a hand. So, tell me, Toby, why did you come back?
A shadow crept across the gray, exhausted face.
It seemed like the right thing to do at the time. My life was here, my dealer, my publisher, my family, a woman. Do you still think it was the right thing to do? No, I think I was an idiot. What do you think, Herr Sturmbannfuhrer?
They both laughed. Max turned the page, hoping for another sexy pose. But the drawing that followed was a portrait of a woman, handsome, with a long, thin nose, dark eyes, and the traces of a knowledgeable smile playing about sensuous lips.
Who's this?
There was an uncharacteristic halt in Toby's voice when he answered.
My mother.
Max surveyed the drawing for a time before he spoke.
She looks very intelligent, he said, and yet like she is a woman who enjoys life.
Toby's face took on a healthy color when he smiled.
That's her, exactly. She was a dress designer up until the war. I must have inherited her artistic sensibilities. My father was an academic, a physicist. He was obsessed with the study of time. Can we go back in time, forward in time? Are there universes parallel to our own? Is it possible to exist in a time other than the present? It could get very abstract. Where are your parents now? Are they in the ghetto with you? They were taken away in April, said Toby.
The afflicted look that lifted when he talked about the past returned, drew a curtain over the conversation.
I should go, he said, unmolding himself from the chair. It's late. Are you kidding? Max objected. It's past curfew. You'll be shot.
Toby shrugged his thin shoulders and smiled his cynical smile as if to say, at least it will be quick.
It hasn't happened yet.
So, this was his regular routine.
Yes, well, they're trigger-happy tonight. There was an Actia at the hospital, another one at the orphanage. You're not going anywhere.
He sank slowly into the chair.
Is that what all the shooting was about? Yes.
Toby looked like he might faint. Max leaned forward, gripped his arm.
Come on, Toby, have some courage. Better them than you, he said.
When the artist opened his eyes again, he looked ill.
Lie down, Max instructed him gruffly, getting off the bed. You look terrible. I'll bring you a blanket. You're sleeping here tonight.
She's here, said his secretary.
Oh, good, said Max.
He hurried to his office, careful to close the door behind him.
So glad that you could come, Fräulein Roschitzky, he said enthusiastically, turning to the woman seated in the chair. Did my secretary offer you something to drink? Tea? Coffee?
No, thank you, she said.
She was struggling with her composure, as any woman would when called upon to visit the offices of the Gestapo on Staromyska Street.
And it's Lipova now. I'm married. What have I done? I have a right to know why I'm here.
He was relieved to hear that she spoke good German. So few Poles did. Without the need for a translator, their conversation could be kept quiet.
It's nothing like that. This is a social visit. It turns out we have a mutual friend.
Her expression showed that she found that difficult to believe. Max was struck by the feeling that he had seen her somewhere before.
The artist, Tobias Ray.
Few words could have had a greater impact, he was sure. Her face blanched as white as her pearls. Spots of color burned high on her cheeks, contrasting attractively with her milky skin.
So he's alive, she said with a rush of emotion. Thank God.
Then, reacting with despair, I had hoped he might have escaped by now. She put a gloved hand to her forehead, an eloquent gesture of grief. He hastened to reassure her.
Don't worry, he's safe. You could say I am his protector.
She needed a moment to take in the information. Clearly, hearing his name had been an enormous shock. Emotions collided across the even surface of her flawless face.
How is he?
She said, feigning something like normalcy.
Oh, he's fine now that I'm looking after him. He's painting for me. Some scenes from In the Land of Armadillos.
A light came into her eyes.
I worked with him on that one.
You were his translator.
Yes, on that one and two others. The Thief of Yesterday and Tomorrow. Also, The Town Inside the Hourglass. How did you know?
Max was very proud of his detective work.
Bianca Roschitzky. He wouldn't tell me your name. I had to call the publisher to find you. Were those also for children?
None of them were for children.
She turned her lovely head toward him, surprised.
Have you ever read any of his books, Sturmbannführer?
He was insulted.
Of course. In the Land of Armadillos is my son's favorite storybook. I've read it many times.
You'll know this, then. In the story, the armadillos live alongside the cockatoos for years, peacefully sharing the savannah, until an armadillo named Lazarus comes along and tells the others that cockatoos are bad, greedy creatures. The armadillos trample the blue cockatoo's favorite food, the indigo plant, and then they drink up all the water. In town, they don't let them rest in the trees, and they close down all the birdseed stores. The cockatoos fly away, never to return. On his way home after the celebration, an armadillo named Aramis comes across a cockatoo hiding in the roots of a baobab tree. Because of a broken wing, she is unable to leave with the others.
Bianca, he said helpfully.
He was listening with rapt attention. It was thrilling to hear the story told by someone involved in its creation. she continued. He takes pity on her, brings her home and fixes up her wing, tells her she can stay until she heals. Though she is a bird and he is an armadillo, they fall in love. In the meantime, things aren't going well in town. No one knows how to make the armadillo's favorite poppy seed cookies. The cafes closed down because the cockatoos were the only waiters. And finally, no one can purchase new shoes when their old ones wear out, because the cockatoos were the cobblers, too. Aramis realizes that if he and Bianca want to be together, they must leave. They move to Paris, where they open a cafe, the Blue Cockatoo. It's a smashing success, welcoming all kinds of animals, two-legged, four-legged, and flying. They live happily ever after. She cocked her eyebrows at him. What does that sound like to you, Herr Sturmbannführer?
It's about an armadillo and a cockatoo, he replied, thinking of himself and Gerda. They are very different from each other in many ways. Maybe their families don't approve of the match, but they love each other above all, so they move away.
She regarded him as if he were an interesting exhibit at a museum.
The cockatoo, he said suddenly. Her name is Bianca.
The meaning of the coincidence dawned on him.
He named her after you.
She bowed her head graciously, permitted him a small smile.
You left him when the war started, he went on, trying to work it all out. Because of the anti-Jewish laws, I presume.
I left him? She repeated in disbelief, her eyes narrowing. Is that what he said? Let me enlighten you, Sturmbannführer. After he came back from the United States, he was afraid. Things had deteriorated. He thought I'd be harassed, beaten, maybe worse. So he told me he didn't want to see me anymore. Max was astounded. He tried to imagine having the strength to leave Gerda, faced with a similar situation, and he realized he would never do it. He couldn't survive without her.
That was very noble of him.
Oh, yes, very noble. My hero. Of course, he didn't ask me what I wanted. He made the decision for both of us. I would have been happy to face those pigs together with him.
Max was surprised at her vehemence, at the hurt Toby's betrayal still inspired.
But how can that be? He came back from New York, where he would have been safe, to be with his family, his girlfriend. I don't understand.
She stared past him, out the window at the market square, giving him the opportunity to observe her in profile. The almond-shaped eyes, blue, gray, hazel, were spaced widely apart and set into high-chiseled cheekbones. There was a straight, regal nose and a domed forehead that gave way to hair the color of a wheat field in autumn. She was like a poster advertising Aryan perfection.
He didn't come back for me, she said, biting off the words. He broke it off with me a week after he returned. I don't think it was for his family, either. They begged him to stay. Now, I have another theory about why he came back to Poland. I think that for him, it was too easy over there in America. Too easy to be a Jew, too easy to be an artist, too easy to be alive. Celebrated not for his work, but for his status as a refugee.
Look, there goes Tobias Ray. He escaped from the Nazis' clutches.
And then they patted him on the head and invited him to dinner, and they gave him a job in one of their nice, safe schools, where there were 100 wealthy girls who all wanted to be titillated by his terrible stories before they fell into his bed. He could say anything he pleased, do anything he liked. It cost him nothing, and it gave him nothing. It was too easy to forget the real world out there, beyond Coney Island, where knowing the wrong people or being born to the wrong parents could mark the difference between life and death. Here, each tiny gesture matters. Every breath of a condemned man is an act of defiance. That's why he came back.
Max tried to get the visit back on track.
Excuse me, Frau Lipova. I apologize if I am bringing up sad memories. But the reason I brought you here, what I would really like to know, is if he has always been this way.
He laced his fingers together, leaned across the desk.
I know something about Jews, Fräulein, he said. Generally, they are cooperative, they are helpful. They beg to be given a chance to be useful. They want to live, you see. Toby doesn't do any of those things. In fact, he does exactly the opposite. If I had to describe him, I would say he is a man who is waiting to die.
Look around, she said bitterly. Can you blame him?
The war will not last forever, he reminded her, ignoring the provocation. He's an essential worker to the Reich. He's safe, he has plenty to eat. You would think he'd cheer up a bit.
She looked closely at the man behind the desk. In his 30s, not thin but not heavy either. Just now an earnest expression on his blunt bully's face. She noticed, too, the black uniform trimmed with silver braid, the SS eagle on the cuff, the twin lightning slashes on the collar, the red swastika armband, the gun in the smooth leather holster on his belt.
Why is this so important to you, Sturmbannführer? She asked curiously.
Years later at the trial, she would recount this part of the conversation, and his response would save him from the gallows.
I don't know, Max admitted,
his voice dropping a notch lower as he probed himself for an answer.
It's not like me at all. I've seen many people die, Frau Lipova. I won't get into the specifics, and usually what I feel is nothing. The way I see it is, today it's them, tomorrow it's me. It's a throw of the dice who gets the bullet. But with Toby, there's something about him, I can't explain it. I don't care whether he is a Jew, a Catholic, or a Buddhist.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.